Okay, well, I'm going to get things started here. Hello and welcome everyone to our event this evening featuring contemporary artists Fernando Orellana, Tony Oursler, and Rachel Rose in conversation with curator Robert Cozzolino. I'm Lauren Applebaum, the Jim and Betty Becker Curator of American Art at the North Carolina Museum of Art and the former Associate Curator of American Art at the Toledo Museum. And we are pleased to be joined by all of you this evening. We are beyond delighted that you're as excited to hear from these speakers as we are. Before we get started, I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the land that we're coming to you from this evening. As the hosting institution, the Toledo Museum of Art is located on the ancestral homelands of the Erie, Kickapoo, Ottawa, and Seneca. Many other Native tribes have also conducted trade on and called this region their home, including the Lenape, Miami, Ojibwe, Peoria, Potawatomi, Sauk, Shawnee, and the Wyandot. The Toledo Museum acknowledges and honors the past, present, and future lives of Indigenous peoples in the Toledo area and thanks them for their resilience as stewards of the land on which the museum now resides. This evening, this event is being held in conjunction with the exhibition Supernatural America, the Paranormal in American Art, which in many ways addresses this notion that America is haunted, that ghosts from our past are an inescapable part of the nation's heritage. Through times of mourning and trauma, artists have been integral to tapping into the supernatural and visualizing the unseen, showing us that otherworldly visitors are an unsettled part of our present. Stories that are told address national traumas associated with the country's origins, from enslavement, genocide, and wartime violence. They tell of apparitions and explore objects and rituals for summoning spirits, and they investigate encounters with life beyond Earth. As you will all see in tonight's dialogue, video, new media, and digital technology are particularly potent media for exploring these issues, and we're honored to have these artists in conversation with one another about these topics. Supernatural America is on view at the Toledo Museum through September 5th. The show will then travel to the Speed Museum in Louisville, where it'll be up from October 7th to January 2nd. And it will close at its organizing institution, the Minneapolis Institute of Art, from February 19th to May 15th. While circumstances in our world are making it difficult for many of you who are tuning in from far away to visit the Toledo Museum in person, we're grateful for the opportunity to connect with all of you virtually and hope that you'll be able to see this exhibition at one of its venues. I'd like to take a moment to thank the people who've helped bring this exhibition into being. Supernatural America is organized by our colleagues at the Minneapolis Institute of Art. It has been made possible in part by the National Endowment for the Humanities, the National Endowment for the Arts, and the Terra Foundation for American Art. The exhibition is sponsored locally in Toledo by the 2021 exhibition program sponsors Taylor Cadillac and Prometica, presenting sponsors Susan and Tom Palmer, and with additional support from the Ohio Arts Council. We're going to begin this evening with brief introductions before turning it over to our speakers. We'll then open it up for an audience Q&A. Since this is a webinar, we won't be able to see or hear anyone who's in attendance, but we do want to invite you all to enter any questions that you have for our speakers in the Q&A box at the lower center of your screen. You can enter questions as they come to mind throughout the presentations or later during the conversation, and I'll pose them to our speakers at the end of the program as time permits. I should also say that this event is being recorded and will be posted online for later viewing. And it is now my great pleasure to introduce our speakers. Fernando Orellana has collaborated with robots for over 20 years to make artwork from robots that print sculptures to extruders that birth Play-Doh populations and machines that are designed for ghosts to operate. As a machine designer, a technologist, and a user, Orellana has blurred the line between himself and the machine in the creative process. The imagery and narrative that Orellana and his robots explore spans a spectrum from the generatively made to the subconsciously driven. He has exhibited in a variety of national and international venues, including the Spring Break Art Show in New York, the Philadelphia Academy of the Fine Arts, Three Rivers Arts Festival, the Everson Museum of Art, the Cultural Center of Spain in El Salvador, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Barcelona, and many other venues. He's the recipient of the 2015 Public Art Network Year in Review, the 2014 Vilcek Foundation Dartboard Award, and the 2009 New York Federation for the Arts Fellowship in Digital and Electronic Arts. Currently, he's an associate professor of digital art in the Visual Arts Department at Union College. He received a Master of Fine Arts from Ohio State University and a Bachelor of Fine Arts at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. Our next speaker, Tony Oursler, has been a pioneer of new media art since the mid-1970s. He's best known for his video projections and installation works that explore technology's effects on the human mind, often commenting on humanity's compulsive relationship with computers and virtual networks. Oursler conveys the emotions that arise from technological dependence, the obsession, escapism, isolation, and sexual fetish. Applying humor and irony to his wide range of work, which has included painting, installation, performance, and sculpture, Oursler elevates everyday things from above the mere objectivity to solidify their impact on contemporary culture. He has now had countless exhibitions worldwide, and his work is collected by significant institutions like the Tate and the Museum of Modern Art. His largest retrospective to date, Black Box, opened last year at Kaohsiung Museum of Fine Arts in Taiwan, and his latest show, Specular, is slated to open at Austria's Kunstraum Dornbirn on September 2nd. Rachel Rose is an American visual artist known for her video installations. Her work explores how our changing relationship to landscape has shaped storytelling and belief systems. She draws from and contributes to a long history of cinematic innovation, and through her subjects, whether investigating cryogenics, 17th century agrarian England, the American Revolutionary War, modernist architecture, or the sensory experience of walking in outer space, she questions what it is that makes us human and the ways that we seek to alter and escape that designation. She's exhibited her work in solo exhibitions at venues including Pond Society, Lafayette Anticipations, the Philadelphia Museum of Art, the Aspen Art Museum, the Whitney Museum of American Art, and many others. Her work has also been featured in the 2018 Carnegie International, the 2017 Venice Biennale, the 2016 Sao Paulo Biennial, and numerous other group exhibitions. Rose was also the recipient of the 2015 Freeze Artist Award. It is now my pleasure to turn things over to our moderator for the evening. Robert Cozzolino is the organizing curator of Supernatural America, and he is the Patrick and Amy Butler Curator of Paintings at the Minneapolis Institute of Art. So please join me in welcoming Bob Cozzolino.
Thank you, Lauren, and thank you to Rachel, Tony, and Fernando for taking part in this. I also want to express my gratitude to the Toledo Museum for hosting the exhibition and tonight's conversation. I am speaking to you from what we now call Minneapolis, which is Dakota land, the ancestral home of the Dakota, Ojibwe, and Ho-Chunk people, who I am honored to call my friends, relations, and sometime collaborators. Our conversation tonight with Fernando, Tony, and Rachel is one of many that will occur while the exhibition is on tour. One aim is to bring to light the living artists included in this exhibition who have made work that thoughtfully engages issues of the supernatural and paranormal, especially those who practice in dialogue with the past. Practitioners such as mediums and investigators such as inventors and scientists have long recognized the relationship between unexplained phenomena and technology. Some have created devices to facilitate spirit communication, detect parallel worlds, make visible that which cannot be seen with unaided eyes, or report effects of phenomena on technology. The spiritual and the scientific have a complex and fascinating history. So tonight's featured artists each have a major piece in the exhibition that connects with these histories. Before we hear from them, I want you, the audience, if you haven't seen the show or are not familiar with their work, to have a sense of their work and how it actually operates in motion, because these are all multi-sensory pieces. We'll see short excerpts of their pieces in action, and Lauren is going to do the honors of keying some of these up. So first we're gonna see an excerpt showing Fernando's piece, His Minerals, which is titled, it's titled His Minerals. In his one bedroom house, he left behind his collection of minerals and the last batch of incense that he crafted from 2012. It's a ghost machine that Fernando designed to hold objects that belong to a man who died and can be operated by his spirit. Thank you, Lauren. And then Tony's piece, Dust, from 2006, is part of an installation called Thought Forms. And this is a large fiberglass sculpture in the exhibition upon which a foggy shifting mass of body parts, eyes, and mouths is projected. And it's also accompanied by sound. It was in part inspired by the 1901 book, Thought Forms, a record of clairvoyant investigation, and presents as a magnified particle of dust teeming with information and life. And then finally, Rachel's Will-O-Wisp from 2018 was commissioned by the Philadelphia Museum and follows the fictional character of Elspeth Blake and her experiences as a mother, mystic, healer, and woman persecuted for connection to the spirit world, weaving together the harsh realities of rural England in the 1600s with ghosts and magic. This piece considers how our perceptions of the world change as society experiences upheavals and a realignment of values. Thank you.
privatized greed disturbed the peace their town once knew. Victimized by selfish lies, charges against Elspeth would accrue. A farmer said she stole his crops, picked a batch of peas without consent. When asked if she'd return the stock, they say she cast a spell on him as revenge. A man refused to lend his horse to her, and all his horses died in the night. He said that Elspeth cursed their lives.
Thanks again, Lauren. So welcome everybody. I wanted to start with a question for Fernando to get us thinking about some of this stuff, because when I first started formulating this exhibition officially at MIA, it coincided with a project that Fernando was doing at the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts, where I had worked, but I had already moved on with Jody Throckmorton, who's the curator of contemporary art there. It was when you were working on that with Jody that I first learned about your ghost machines, and that you were working on a project with artifacts that Thomas Aikens had used in his painting practice, a chair for his sitters, his palette, and other kinds of painting materials, but is also situated in a contemporary art space in the Furness Building, the 1876 historic landmark building, which I know is haunted. So there's a lot of intense kind of layers of history that you were already kind of working with on site. And then you got to use the actual materials in formulating the ghost machine. And then you also got to use a live model, because of course it's an art school and a museum. So could you just talk a bit about how that Aikens ghost machine came about and how it plays into your interest in technology and the spiritual?
Oh yeah, I'd be happy to. First, thank you, Bob, for inviting me to the exhibition, and Lauren for helping with all, also Duffy, just a round of applause for all of you guys for doing this. The path of so really came about because it's funny, because Jody just basically made a Google search for artists working with ghosts. And I happen to be already involved in designing machines for the dead. That really came from kind of a design point of view. Like if I, you know, an industrial design point of view, really, like if you were to design stuff for the dead, how would you go about doing it, right? And how would you how would you have someone interact with an object if they can't necessarily learn how to deal with the object? And after, you know, in the beginning it was more of a thought experiment, and then I arrived at using objects that I had found at estate sales, which felt like the dead might already recognize, so I wouldn't necessarily have to like teach them anything. So, you know, after several works, including his minerals that it's in your exhibition, Jody approached me and said, well, what would you do if, you know, we allowed you to have sort of fair game of full access to our collection? And I knew that Thomas Aikens had, you know, taught there, and also, you know, one of my favorite paintings of all time, the Gross Clinic, is also in the area. I think that they co-own it. Mm-hmm. So I took the chance
it's
to
like sort a of, timeshare.
Yeah, it's like a timeshare. And so I jumped at the chance of jumping into the collection, and one of the first things that she showed was this, you know, the paint box of Thomas Aikens, which was just this amazing opportunity to look at an object. And up until that point, I didn't really know the story behind the objects that I was encountering. I just had a sense from visiting estate sales of what the object story might be. And I kind of came up with the rest, you know, kind of on artistic license. But at PAFA, I really had the opportunity to know exactly what those objects, who owned them, who had manipulated them, what they were used for. And so it was this sort of great opportunity to expand the idea of machines for the dead. What was great is that they lent us the palette, and it turns out that that palette was also used after Eakins dies. His wife uses his palette for years and years as well. So most likely the last painting that was made through that palette was her. So there's like a twofer ghost there.
Yeah. And Susan McDowell Aikens made these amazing self-portraits when she was at the end of her life. So that's also kind of this wonderful connection.
And then not knowing that the institution was haunted, you know, was kind of fun because the staff was so willing to help me try to push that story forward more. And it, you know, it was just sort of this kind of curious collaboration really between me and the staff and Jody, the curator, to arrive at something that was kind of like site specific. And, you know, we basically took it apart at the end because it didn't work anywhere else. It was very specific to the artwork, using technology to try and facilitate Aikens and his wife. I'm sorry, I always forget her name. What was her name again?
Susan McDowell Aikens.
Susan, right, yeah. To try to facilitate them working from the great beyond. And since he was a professor, I thought it would be interesting to allow basically like an artist studio or a professor studio, life drawing. And I know that PAFA created curriculum around it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, for basically 3 months, they had a live human body standing in pose, using the poses that Aikens had used, because he was a great technologist as well, one of the first to use photography in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where we arrived at.
So one of the things that happened is that it started to operate without anybody's intervention. Yeah.
So there was a machine that I designed for him to come and draw, which was the most elaborate machine I've ever made for a ghost. It was basically like a paranormal joystick. So like a ghost could come and operate this sort of like XY table and, you know, using their ghost hand, I guess, could move.
Do we have an image of it that Lauren could throw up?
Yeah, maybe Lauren can put that image up. I don't know what's happening, but let's see.
But that's okay. Yeah, it started to move, or it started to draw, right?
So it was designed to, yeah, so there's the palette that we sort of created, or I created this system so that he could select color. And if Lauren, if you go back a slide, I believe you'll see there's the machine and a chair waiting for him to come and sit down and draw. And that chair on the right, you'll see, if you're Aikens fans, you'll probably recognize that chair. It's one of the chairs that in his studio. If you go forward two slides, one and then the other. Yeah, so this is the brush that Aikens used to come, you know, and something familiar to him. I had to be encased in plastic because obviously it's a, what's it called? A priceless object now. But so the machine was designed to let him draw live, but it was also designed to draw one of his photos in case he didn't want to draw. He would actually like automatically draw one of his photos. And in during the show, what happened is that event, which by the way, is improbable that event could happen because the machines are designed to detect electromagnetic fields, temperature, and infrared light. And if two of those three sensors go, you know, high or, you know, are true, it triggers the machine. But it's almost impossible unless you're messing with it. No one knows the recipe really. So if you go to the next slide, the machine ended up making a drawing. And to this day, I still don't really know how it was triggered. It was programmed to print those images. It had five images in its memory to print. But what's curious about this particular layering is the first image is of his wife, Susan.
Right.
And the second image is of him. It's right. A self-portrait of yeah. him. And so it appears that he's standing in front of her.
I mean, why beat a bear on a bush? It's obvious why it happened, Fernando.
I mean, like, I think more like from a science point of view. So
yeah.
I when Jody called me haunted, most of the museum was haunted at that point.
Yeah.
You know, I traveled to Philly and I looked at the machine and I tried to figure out what happened. And Bob, to this day, it's one of the unexplained phenomenons with these machines that there's only been two other events and this is one of them.
Yeah.
Where I can't really explain. What's great is that a new artwork was created during that moment, and it's not this drawing. It's the ghost story that now the staff has
sure.
of,
right.
you know, of this moment.
Yeah.
They acquired the drawing as well, the museum, so that they could have it. And it just was this curious moment. To me, the coincidence of the two images that were chosen, at random, but who knows, were curious. You can see his face in there too. It's very bizarre.
Yeah, right. Well, so one of the things that is an unlikely link between the three of you besides technology is that you all have in your practice a really deep respect for histories and the archive and thinking about the past and the present and how they overlap and inform one another. And so you also do research. And Rachel, that's one of the things that I know you've talked about when you were developing Will-O-Wisp, but also Enclosure, which is a piece that you made afterwards, or maybe you were overlapping those two pieces, you know, that look into the, you know, histories of women living at that time that is set for Will-O-Wisp. And also, you know, you've talked about in interviews experiencing lots of coincidences around the time that you were developing it and thinking about how people in the past would have interpreted those. And so I just wonder if you could talk a little bit about that with regard to Will-O-Wisp. And I know that the piece in the show is shown on a monitor, but when you originally exhibited it, it was this immersive installation with all sorts of other kinds of parts and ways that people would be, their perception would be affected by what was around it. There you go.
Yeah, I guess I should say all of my work usually starts with kind of just an everyday thing that's around me or I'm experiencing, and then I wonder about it. And the time I was experiencing coincidences a lot, and so I started researching coincidences, and one of the things that came up was the way that coincidence was considered in agrarian England, the way that people thought about magic and ciphers in nature. And so I wrote this story about a woman, a fantasy woman, Elspeth Blake, who is a healer and a witch and an interpreter in a way of coincidences for a community. But as the land starts to be bought and deforested and split up and resold during the enclosure movement, women like her became the town healer, interpreters, spiritual guide, political center, became the witch. So Will-O-Wisp is about that transformation in the landscape and how in a sort of violence towards women, it's also a kind of violence towards magic or sublimination of magic into something else.
Mm-hmm.
An Enclosure, the next film I made, was a continuation of that. I started researching it while I was making Will-O-Wisp. Mm-hmm. And that's set a bit later in 17th century agrarian England as well, about swindlers hustling people out of their land during the enclosure movement. But the main character there is an alchemist, and he practices mm-hmm. alchemy. Mm-hmm. And he practices actual magic. And so both were sort of excuses for me to look into how magic existed then as a way of thinking about its continuity into our present now. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that came up is, like, for example, when I was making Enclosure, that moment in agrarian England, it's really the beginning of a cash economy. A lot before then, in serf structured societies, there really wasn't cash or money. Mm-hmm. And it's no coincidence that magic gets subliminated with, you know, science and reason and deforestation and the Enlightenment that mm-hmm. sort of like encroaches on that moment, and that money gets invented at the same time. And so, you know, I was thinking about ways that our lives are, that we don't call it magic, but we exist through money, frankly, in a completely magical universe, like sure. Us doing this conversation right now.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah. You know, the pieces in the installation, and probably in all three places, it'll be like this. Is one of the first things it's in the first room, and it's in one of the first sort of juxtapositions with other kinds of early American painting that's about the haunted landscape, but also you know, one of the aims of the show with regard to spirit artists who identified as mediums first and foremost, is to talk about them in a new way and talk about women's power and authority and agency in a different way with regard to the role of mediums in spiritualism, because you know, there's been a lot of great work by scholars like Molly McGarry and others about how mediums were talked about in the 19th century as being ideal if they were passive receptacles for the spirit. But if you really look at the way that they were operating and managing their own persona as mediums who were touring the country and speaking truth on stage in a way that they couldn't in any other way. You know, I wrote about them in the catalog is particularly with spirit artists who are reclaiming authorship and saying that historically famous artists who were men were speaking through them, and then they could control sort of what came out. You know, it's recentering women in spiritualism as makers that had this great power and authority. And so, you know, in your piece, in some ways, I feel like that character is cast that way, and it's a very empathetic and important way of seeing who those people were in those societies before they were demonized. Mm. I don't know if any of that resounds with you as you were thinking about those two pieces and how you would think about the role of women in them, but you know, it's all over kind of how the spiritualists think about a non-hierarchical religion and the role of women in that particular religion. Mm. Anyway, you know, you also have this new series of landscapes that have their video pieces, where there's sort of a section of a landscape, and there's a, you know, a heron or no, an egret and other animals, and then there's this orb or this egg in the background. And the first thing I thought of when I was looking at those pieces was, you know, the monolith, which is, I'm sorry, but you know, from 2001, but also just this idea of the persistence of there's these, you know, the natural state of the world, but then this unknowable, strange, is it technology or is it something else that's kind of hovering in the background, and the tension between them. And in your pieces, these new pieces that people can see on your gallery's website, it doesn't seem threatening or ominous. It's like it's in balance, but I wonder how you think about those and where they came from after doing these two longer pieces.
Yeah, well, actually, they come from an interest in alchemy. The egg is as the original alchemical symbol. And actually, I started them when I was thinking about becoming pregnant with my daughter, who's now two. Mm-hmm. So I started them, let's say, 3 years ago.
Okay.
And I was, I had never understood how ovulation and reproduction actually works. And it's totally alchemical, but also defining when an egg, which is the start of our bodies, our human mm-hmm. life, when that egg is created is completely ambiguous, because for example, the eggs that are inside me that produced my daughter, the one egg that produced my daughter and the other that produced my son, were inside me when I was inside my mother's body.
Right.
Which means that my daughter and my son, in a way, were inside my mother. And so the egg is not only like this, the symbol of alchemical creation, but also the complete diffuseness of how we define life. It's like this, this thing that's so defined, there's such a clear outside and an inside with an egg. When you crack it, it's broken, it's pure entropy. When it's whole, it's perfectly interior and exterior, not porous at all. And yet it's where it emerges from is, or the time that it that emerges from, you can't really say. So I got really interested in eggs at that time. Incidentally, I look back on my previous works and there are eggs in all of my works, but that's
well,
when
the
I-
the sort of glass elements that are in the installation for the original presentation of Will-O-Wisp, right?
Or yeah, no? So that I was actually, those are original 17th century lenses. So early, at the time I was thinking about John Dee and John Dee's optic, his, oh my gosh, I'm blanking on the name, the black obsidian mirror that he used, and all the kind of optical devices that alchemists and magicians were using at the time. And it was crazy to understand that they were quite simple in a way, that it's just glass and cured water. That's how lenses were made at the time. And so I just went about making my own lenses, and that's what those are. So yeah. But they're also shaped like eggs, so.
Yeah. Well, you know, a lot of this kind of comes together organically in the things that you've talked about with regard to your piece Dust, Tony. And so, you know, you've, in the piece that you wrote for the catalog on Dust, you talk about how in some ways you were thinking about how we're all connected on this molecular level and that we're inhaling dust that could have been flying around the atmosphere of the planet that also was shared by other people in history, and how, you know, changes in the environment that are intangible affect personality and fate and all these other kinds of things. And that that giant magnified piece of dust that is in the installation, this large fiberglass sculpture with all the mutating forms around it, sort of a allegorical manifestation of those ideas. And so, you know, when Rachel's talking about this idea that's quite amazing of her children as eggs being inside of her when she's in her mother, it really seems to sort of connect to some of the aims that you talk about with thinking about dust. And you also talk about thinking about after 9/11 too. So a lot of comes together in that piece.
Absolutely. Yeah, the thinking about kind of interconnectivity and the way that it works on a kind of level of memes in popular culture, technology, but actually sort of scientifically when it comes down to something like dust, you know, and how, you know, materials move from one dimension to another. I mean, it's interesting, you know, Fernando and Rachel are talking about a lot of ideas that kind of resonate throughout the whole show, you know, like alchemy, for example, is a precursor to, you know, chemistry, but, you know, it became a kind of debunked, a sort of debunked activity, but there's still a kind of impulse to grasp the spirit of the materials, you know, that kind of even translates into, say, minimalism or something, you know. And so I'm very interested in these kind of, you know, minimal art, you know, where you look like Don Judd and people working with molten lead and so forth, and then how that kind of could connect back to actually, you know, medieval alchemy and the way creativity occurs. And then you know, looking at that, my piece Dust, as you mentioned, had to do with a moment after thinking about 9/11, you know, because I was very near the World Trade at the time, and that was a quite a literal transcription there. But there was also a great inspiration which came from the Thought Forms book, which was a kind of, you know, as I mentioned, I'm interested in these kind of overlapping histories. So if you look at, you know, I'm kind of post-conceptualist. I studied with Doug Hubler and Michael Asher, John Baldessari, people like that, Laurie Anderson. And, what you know, kind of looking back at the idea of conceptual art and then discovering the book Thought Forms and seeing that there was this sort of spiritual, theosophical, pop cultural discovery of this kind of pure embodiment of thought at that time was a revelation to me, this kind of shadow history. And so that's been a way that my studio works and the way that I come up with projects. You know, that particular piece was shown at Metro Pictures, and there were four or five parts of it. You know, there was a mercury piece, a kind of metallic piece, and there was also a water piece called Nyx. And so there, it was a kind of real contemplation on these different materials, and that I was obsessed with at that time.
Yeah, I think people can, if people go to your website, they can see installation and films of people walking through that particular installation of Metro Pictures. Sure. Well, also, Tony, I wanted to mention how, I mean, you've been a pioneer with using technology and art and thinking about different ways and unexpected ways to use it, but you're also deeply invested in the history of the occult and esoteric investigations into the unexplained. And so you have this whole archive, and you very generously have lent pieces from your archive to the show. But you know, you also have a good deep knowledge of earlier technologies of the spiritual. And I just wonder how much inspiration you have gotten from specific kinds of objects like that from the past. You know, even Thomas Edison at one point patented a ghost talking machine. You know, so lots of different inventors from across, you know, a broad range of backgrounds tried to make a device that either quantified or proved the existence of other universes or dimensions or planes of existence. And so in some ways, you sort of, I always think of your work as kind of envisioning what would it might look like there, but how much have you like kind of drawn from that? Or is it just an interest that you like to look at?
You know, I think it comes from the idea that, of course, being a, you know, having lived at this moment where, you know, we've got a cell phone in your pocket that's more powerful than the computer that was used to land on the moon. And, you know, so kind of, you know, rethinking art history, rethinking, you know, this kind of two-dimensional classical art forms of painting and sculpture and so forth, and kind of rethinking the moving image is, I think, the major project that I'm interested in. And also kind of presenting alternatives, I guess, is what I really love about this kind of occult shadow history, and that how, you know, there's materialism is kind of invested in reading history, and a lot of recent art history has come around to shifting to bringing people in, you know. So I think one of my interests in looking at this kind of alternative histories was the idea of bringing people in, celebrating a kind of creativity that will invigorate people, you know, because the traditional look at any kind of technology is, you know, once something is kind of landed in the economic zone of capitalism, you know, it gets streamlined. And I think in the arts, one of the beautiful things is whereas film and computers and video can wander along a circuitous creative path of alternatives. You know, like you can't go into the movie theater and see a Rachel Rose installation, or you can't yet go into a mall and see Fernando's installation or something, you know. But it could be that there could be another reality where this happens. You know, right now you have to go to the art museum and see that. But if you would imagine a different sort of reality, which I think we're all trying to push forward, you know, these kind of creative endeavors could be more widely dispersed, you know. So I think that's part of the overall influence. But as you mentioned, the kind of collecting aspect of it, which I think we all of us here kind of share, you know, this kind of rethinking of history, has been a great inspiration to me, you know, and the way of bringing in a kind of focus of contemporary imagery and recent past, you know, and kind of rereading that. I mean, materialism has been invested in kind of the myth of disenchantment. And in fact, there's been a kind of permanent enchantment that I think you chart in your project. And we need to sort of spin that into a positive direction, you know, which isn't about like whether somebody believes in one certain perspective, you know, or not. Which I won't go into the religious side of it, but let that roll.
Well, so, you know, another thing that has kind of happened, there are a lot of coincidences along the way while I was working on the show. So, you know, I share that with you, Rachel. And, you know, part of it I feel like is how people have talked about paranormal phenomena, that when you're starting to engage it and walking towards it, it seems like it multiplies and is attracted. And so I felt that while working on the project, but also, you know, working on it and doing a lot of the logistical work last year, with all sorts of colleagues during the pandemic, you know, there's been a lot of conversations that are just about the nature of mourning and grief and loss. And also when we're thinking about technology, there's this resurgence in interest in the Pentagon's, you know, unidentified flying objects, or the new name they have for it, report. And I just wonder, you know, have the three of you experienced in the last year and a half this sense that there's a turn to being more, the culture and people around you being more interested in supernatural and paranormal phenomena or subjects, or is this just a sort of always something that's in culture?
The UFO thing has definitely reached a crescendo in pop culture right now, mostly driven by that report that turned out to be just a bore from the Fed. So I think that was fueling it, but you know, the mass media loves those headlines. And so I think that speaks to what you're saying, is that it's always been, it's our fascination to wonder what happens when we breathe our last breath. Mm-hmm. And it's never going away. We're always gonna be fascinated by what's next. And so I think it's just this ongoing story, right? That that we can't quiet. I think it's one of the first questions we ask when we're little kids. I'm sure your kids are probably already asking you.
Yeah.
And it's with us till the end. So it's always going to fascinate us for sure.
Right, Rachel. I mean, it'll be interesting to know when your kids start answering those questions, because I remember both of my kids being very young and then turning to me one day and just going, how did I get here? Who made me?
What did you say?
I, you know, sort of explained everything matter of fact to them. You know, if they ask questions, we're honest with them. But it was such a mind-blowing question, and it was so young, like this, just suddenly going, how did I get here? What am I made of?
You know, I found really, I recently read that we're dreaming in the womb.
Yeah.
So it could be that reality itself is not the normal moment. It's like we wake up into this world. So there's something that will always be unanswered. We can't answer it.
Yeah, there's a portion of Salvador Dali's autobiography, The Secret Life of Salvador Dali, that's devoted to intrauterine memories.
Mm. Well,
and what did you say?
Do you have those images of George Adamski that we could put up for a second?
Yeah, those UFO images, Lauren. Rachel, what were you saying just a moment ago?
Oh, I was just curious what about the Dali chapter, but I don't want to distract.
Yeah, no, it's his book, The Secret Life of Salvador Dali, and he has little drawings of himself in the womb, but he also talks about how there's images that he remembers from being in the womb, in colors in particular, that then influenced the way he painted later. So yeah, there's a George Adamski photograph.
Yeah, he's arguably one of the first people to bring us images of UFOs. And I wanted to put this up here. Adamski was a autodidact who lived in California. And so he began giving lectures about UFOs in 1949, and the most famous saucer photo, I think, is this one here from 53 or something like that. So, you know, the imagery has changed a lot over the years, but the impulse to fantasize about, you know, terraforming the earth through these kind of fantasies in the sky is pretty fascinating. This image here is quite beautiful, I think. It's small.
Well, and so you've lent some of those in addition to an official Coast Guard photograph of UFOs. But also, didn't you recently acquire his... The apparatus he used to photograph UFOs?
Yeah, one of his telescopes.
Okay.
I managed to get, and the first one I think was destroyed in a fire or something, and I managed to get one, and I think he held a camera up to it, and you know, he was near the Palomar Observatory in California, and these kind of images are, I mean, inspirational to me because of the fantastical quality of them and the believability of it. You know, I'm very interested in belief systems and how they challenge the audience. Because there's something akin to, for example, Kabuki theater, in the sense that you have to have a willing suspension of disbelief to participate in certain ideal constructions. And I think that's operating today with the new footage released from the Pentagon as well. So it's quite interesting to see where that's gonna go, because my personal belief is that it's probably has to do with a big budget item that will materialize in the Pentagon's defense, some kind of space defense system. But it's also interesting how it is a kind of, the original images were kind of connected to more science fiction and science fiction writing, you know, magazines such as Amazing Stories and things like that. So, and space travel in general. I mean, Goddard was even inspired by, you know, War of the Worlds. Mm-hmm. And so there's a kind of beautiful relationship, a kind of weaving in and out of science, actual progression, and these kind of fantasy spaces.
So, you know, I know that I kind of, my brain went to the monolith, Rachel, in your Signs series. But there was something otherworldly and spooky and in feeling like it was this kind of, even though it was this ancient primordial sort of deep-seated image of the egg that's also connected to, as you say, alchemy, it also felt like it was something otherworldly, maybe even hyper technology that's in those landscapes. And you may not have intended that at all, but there's an interesting relationship between that kind of natural, obviously earth environment and then this thing in those Signs images. I wonder if any of this resounds with you or if it's not a direction you're interested in sort of taking the way you deal with this with your film work and other kinds of storytelling.
Completely. Well, actually, I was also very much inspired by Arrival. And one of the things about Arrival that's just so stunning is how simply this idea that you can time travel through language itself is transposed. Mm-hmm. One of the things about having children is that you experience that time travel in real time. Mm-hmm. So I can see that my daughter can spatialize to further extents based on what she can say. And my son can only babble. And so in a way he can't move through space in the same way that she can. She can attach a color to a couch that's in another room. Well, mm-hmm. that's a form of space-time travel. That's what Arrival to me illustrates or makes clear in this thing about the alien language, allowing Amy Adams to the main character to travel to through time. But it illustrates this thing that's very true to us as humans, mm-hmm. Which is that our language allows us to space-time travel. And it's something I think about a lot, not just from the perspective of Arrival and having my own children and seeing them understand space differently, but when I was working on Everything and More in 2015 and I interviewed David Wolf, an astronaut, about his experience in outer space, and then returning back to Earth after seeing the Earth on the night side, so the Earth is a void, total blackness, and being in a spacewalk in front of a voided Earth, basically like the most intense nothing chamber we could be in. And when he comes back to Earth, he describes that, you know, obviously, and this is true for a lot of astronauts, even when they work out in the ISS or whatever, like their muscles are atrophied, they can't walk, they have to relearn, like a baby, they have to relearn things. Mm-hmm. But he also describes a new sense of color and sound when he came mm-hmm. back. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but one thing that makes me think about is how much our bodies are formed by the evolution of the Earth. This is an obvious mm-hmm. thing to say, but our bodies, what we see and hear, is bound by where we are.
Sure.
And so I wonder, like, are we extraterrestrial if we're extracted from the Earth enough? Mm-hmm. So much about UFOs somewhere else, or if our conditions were different, would we start hearing and seeing differently?
Right.
Would we utilize our skin, our bones, our brain, our neurons, would they open up in different ways?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great. And I've never heard anybody make a parallel sort of to astral projection with children and language, the way you did, talking about your daughter talking about the color of a couch in another room. But in some ways, it totally makes sense. I love it. We're at 7 o'clock, well, here we're at 7 o'clock. Which is time travel for you because you're actually an hour ahead of me. So I know we want to get to questions. So Lauren and Duffy, I don't know if we have questions from our audience, but I know these three delightful people would be happy to answer them.
We don't have any questions in the Q&A yet. I want to encourage everybody to go ahead and type in your questions, and maybe while those are starting to trickle in, if you have anything else that you want to continue to add.
Hey, Fernando, what about your students? Like, were they interested in the UFO? Also, there are lots of stories over the last year and a half that were about, you know, just turning to ghosts and ancestors, and in a very serious way, which really resounded with me and fits in with a lot of the material that's in this exhibition. But I just wonder what this generation that you're teaching is thinking about with regard to this stuff.
Really good question. I haven't, you know, this work is kind of a few years old for me now, so
yeah.
I'm not necessarily like on the tip of my tongue with them. I also don't necessarily show them my work really ever, but the UFO phenomenon, there's every so often I'll get a student that makes work about UFOs or about, you know, and they're just in many ways still fringe, you know, the students that dive into that kind of work. But you know, I hadn't noticed any real different, the students' work the last year was 100% about the pandemic and being isolated and right. being, you know, disrupted from their lives, and a lot of, like, unfortunately, mental illness.
Yeah.
Not specifically about anything beyond that they were, you know, really sad and disrupted. But no paranormal events, at least in the kids' work. But beyond that, you know, they might use it as an excuse to not hand it in on time. I saw there was ghosts in my house.
It, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah. No, unfortunately, there's no cool anecdotes on that right now.
Okay.
Great. I have a couple of questions. First one is for Tony. One of our attendees is wondering if you're a fan of the His Dark Materials books.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, the TV show. I think the TV show. I think they make a TV show out of that. Special effects. I love special effects all the time.
All right, our next question, is there an area of the country that has more UFOs than other areas?
Well, you can research that by going to the MUFON website, because they track real-time reporting.
That's really of UFOs. Great site.
There's a US map, and you can see where all the reports are coming from, and they're categorized by technology, sound, phenomena, you know, alien encounters. Tony or Fernando or Rachel, do you know if there's an area of the country that has more sightings? I mean, I'm going to venture Wisconsin, but. Belleville, is it Bellevue, Wisconsin, has an annual UFO parade that's around, is sometime in October. You know, but then obviously there's New Mexico and Colorado, and there's the Skinwalker Ranch. I mean, who knows? Probably people fight over it.
I mean, there area, what is it? Area, you know, 50, whatever it is. And,
51, yeah.
Near the White Sands, I've been there. There's an incredible little museum there. If anybody has a chance, please go there. And it happens to be right next to White Sands missile site, which is good because, you know, in certain areas you see like deer crossing signs or pedestrian crossing signs. There you see missile crossing signs. So there might be some connection, but.
Yeah, coincidence, I don't know.
Are there more haunted places than you? Like, is there areas where people see more ghosts than other places that like is New Orleans or something like that?
I mean, you'd think there's some heavy hauntedness in New Orleans, but also, I mean, Erica at The Speed really wanted the show because she claims that Louisville is one of the most haunted places, or the haunted, most haunted place in the country. But I don't know. That's, again, one of those contentious issues, probably.
Who has the most ghosts?
Yeah, right. Probably where the highest percentage of bad things happened.
Right.
There's no shortage of that, is there, throughout the United States? Anyway, yeah, I don't know. But, you know, to in all seriousness, like one of the, while there's that kind of, those different kinds of aspects of the show, you know, most of what the show is about is this sort of will for contact in realms that are the unseen, and spirit contact, and what it means to have that contact and what comes out of that, and often in a positive way. And certainly that's what the spirit artists in the exhibition were looking for. And, you know, it really didn't come sort of home to me until I went to spiritualist camps like Lilydale and Camp Chesterfield when I was researching spirit artists and mediums and mediumship in the history of spiritualism, that, you know, all the people who are there because they've lost somebody and they're looking for closure and they want some kind of answer or sign and tangible indication that the person who's in spirit that they've lost is okay, or is a presence still in their lives somehow. So, you know, that's, again, that's like pops up in a lot of the work cross-culturally in the exhibition.
You know, when you mentioned that, something that I wasn't prepared for when I dove into this body of work was how many people were going to ask me to produce an artwork for their deceased loved ones.
Right.
And to this day, I don't feel so comfortable when they ask. It is just bizarre. And, you know, one of them after a lecture asked me if I could train her how to use the machine so that when she died, she could use it.
And it, wow, that's intense, man.
It's intense. And you just finished the lecture, so you're like, you don't know what to say. And you're like, sure, like, okay. And then also like another one asked me, you know, her father had just died of cancer and if she could, you know, give me some objects. And thankfully the email threads always end and they never really materialize. Because I am willing to do it because it's a rabbit hole that I'd be curious to go down, but always a little strange for sure. I've never been ready for it. I still to this day I'm not ready for it.
Yeah, there's a lot of hope and optimism and confidence in you in that. you struck a chord with people with those machines when you talk about them.
I wasn't ready for it.
I'm sure.
what strikes me about it is that, you know, this idea of being allowed, having permission to go beyond normal day-to-day life and to go to another level in whatever way possible, what the parallels between art making and kind of seance is what really intrigues me, you know. So what do you think of that, Bob? You know, it's just a way of getting to another level.
Well, so Lauren Thibodeau, who's one of the mediums that I consulted with at Lilydale, who is a trained psychotherapist, psychoanalyst, and she's got a, you know, but she's also been a medium from early in life. A lot of the way that mediums talked about their practice in the 19th century and early 20th century is opening up a channel. And it was thought that they went into these trance states to sort of close off parts. But both she and Susan Barnes, another medium at Lilydale, talked about how you were opening things up so that the spirits came through your unconscious. So that was one of the places where they merged. And Lauren talked about how people will talk about the muse or that voice that's inside of you And spiritualists will recognize that as spirits from the past, your ancestors, other folks who are there, and don't make any distinction between that. You know, it's not, we'll say the muse colloquially, but if you're tapping in and have that ability or that sensitivity, that it's all the stuff that's around us, including these ancestors that are coming in through you and collaborating with your body rather than using your body. So there's so many parallels to how people talk about the creative process or where you get inspiration from in that. Yeah. And so I think there's just so much more to do in this field with regard to people who identify primarily as mediums, but who use visual art or writing as the way that they express themselves or they channel the spirit. So it's all in there and it's complex.
Okay, I have a couple more questions that have come in. One is, can you elaborate on PAFA being haunted? And is there something special about museums that visitors believe them to be haunted?
Fernando, I mean, I worked there, but Fernando, do you have any take on that?
Well, firstly, that's one area, museums being great areas to be haunted. Since the PAFA show, that's what I've been looking for, is another museum to collaborate with to activate their objects. Because I believe, and I don't know if I believe in ghosts, I want to believe in ghosts, but I do believe that we become entangled with the objects that we encounter throughout our lives at the quantum level. I think we become part of them. And so museums are just filled with objects that are connected in another way to the dead. And I would love to sort of tap in more to those, to that possibility. But beyond that, the PAFA haunting, Bob, you could probably speak to what exactly the ghost stories were, but I know that the gallery that we showed in the Morris Gallery was one of the studios of the art school in the beginning, and ghosts have been reported for 100 years there, like not just in that gallery, but throughout, you know, the museum. Mm-hmm. I don't know specifically what the stories were, but all of the staff when I arrived were wanting to tell me the stories, and unfortunately I wasn't able to because I was, you know, working the whole time. But I mean, while you worked there, what did you hear? What did you, you know, Bob, what did you hear about?
I mean, this could take up the next hour. Anna Marley and Jody Throckmorton and Brittany Webb, if any of you are listening in, you need to like do your own show about ghosts, specific to that building. But, you know, I mean, first of all, there's so much intensity with regard to the kind of emotional investment that people have in art, and the Aiken story that he was fired. I mean, he resigned, and how contentious he was as a figure in the Philadelphia art world. You know, of course there's going to be energies that are left behind because of Aiken's, but I mean, I knew staff members who saw things in the basement. There's cold spots, you know, all those kind of quintessential things that ghost investigators describe. I heard voices. I saw things move around. I saw things out of the corner of my eye when I was like downstairs in storage and stuff. And it wasn't, you know, mice. It was other things. So there's plenty of stories that I have, but I know other people had. And at MIA, at the Minneapolis Institute, we've had ghost hunters in because there are lots of independent reports of hauntings that visitors, security folks, and other folks at the museum report. And a lot of it is concentrated in one particular area at the museum, which is called the Connecticut Room. And I know when I first contacted you, I was thinking, boy, it'd be great if Fernando could do something in that room. And also in Minneapolis, there's the Bakken Museum, and Earl Bakken was very much interested early on, even though his museum is devoted to electricity, investigating psychic powers and the existence of psychic energies and all these kinds of things that overlap. So there's a lot of places like this that I think are that. And then just the idea that all of these objects, particularly objects that weren't intended for museums, whether they are altarpieces or they are material from Native American communities, have heavy histories and things attached to them. And I think, of course, if they're in museums and out of place, there's got to be activity around them. So that's part of it, I think.
I've been trying to work with a museum that has a collection of Native American whistles, because I would really love to activate those whistles and let the dead come back and play, you know, a symphony from the great beyond. I just haven't been able to convince anybody to let me do it yet. I'll get there. go ahead, Tony.
You know, like Fred Wilson's Mining the Museum series is one of my favorite series. You know, I don't know if people are familiar with that, but, you know, there's so many overlapping histories in museums, and a lot of it even is what's not been shown, and sort of mining that and exhibiting it again or bringing it to light as Fred Wilson did. But I mean, I think that, you know, Bob's exhibition, what I love about this Supernatural America is that, you know, he's revealing a thread, or the group here is revealing a kind of thread, which is really a lost history kind of suppressed in the kind of contemporary reading of art history. And what's great is that, you know, it's bringing back people who haven't been allowed to be in that line of history. You know, it has a kind of, it's a haunting event in itself, you know.
I think that's a really great place to stop for the evening. I wish we could keep this conversation going. There's just so many interesting things to explore here, but I want to thank you all for joining us and for sharing your work with us this evening. And it's just been really inspiring to learn more about your practices and inspirations. And on behalf of TMA, I want to just thank you all for having this conversation with us. And I want to thank all of our audience members who've joined us for and participating this evening. We appreciate all of you, and take care.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you.